Hello and welcome to my talk on media fluency, developing a new set of skills for music educators. In the time that I've been a college professor, 11 years now, there hasn't been a time where the things that I'm the most interested in and the skills that I have developed the most are in need by people around me than right now. So I'm someone who's been very interested in recording arts over this time. And the idea of producing media, the idea of music teachers as music producers. And so now, more than ever, people are interested in these things. I'd like to share that with you today. So I'm going to talk about speed and accuracy and proper expression. I'm going to talk about media sources, microphones, audio interfaces, computers, live stream software, and video sharing platforms. And then I'm going to show you a lot of examples from practice, and hopefully we'll have some time for questions at the end. So I'm talking about media fluency, so to define it, I like to look at the idea of reading fluency from the general education literature. So we talk about reading fluency, we talk about the ability to read with speed, accuracy, and proper expression. So when thinking about media fluency then, perhaps we can use the definition, the ability to produce media with speed, accuracy, and proper expression. And then media fluency for music teachers then would naturally be the ability of music teachers to produce media with speed, accuracy, and proper expression for the communities that they serve. And so first, let's look at producing media. So there's a history of producing media back to at least the 1920s. If we go back to the development of specific technologies like the microphone that came out of telephone technology, we can go back to the time where people started capturing media for the first time, so capturing audio. And we can think of really the history of sound recording is only 170 years old with Thomas Edison, the development of the disc phonograph and sound on disc technology, sound on wax cylinder technology. And so back in these days, you know, if you wanted to balance a group, you would put the loud people in the back and you'd put the softest people closest to that cone. And so, you know, very early on, the art of being able to do this well has been in constant development. So some of the earliest technologies, of course, the tinfoil phonograph, the wax cylinder phonograph, the gramophone, and this Edison disc phonograph that's in my living room at the moment. And so, you know, fast forward about 30 years from that point, we brought back tape recording technologies from World War II from the Germans, thank you for that. And so we developed our own technologies in the United States. And fast forward a bit more, and now we've got digital ways of capturing audio with Logic Pro X that I use all the time, and of course Pro Tools and FL Studio that a lot of my students enjoy. So this technology then has, all along the way, there have been people that have been very good at doing this. And so one of the pioneers of multi-track recording was Les Paul in the 1950s, recorded himself 25 different times and so came out with recordings that were groundbreaking at the time and still laid the foundation for a lot of the things that we're still doing today. And so people like Quincy Jones and Sam Phillips and George Martin then have had a musical side of this, the task of capturing audio and capturing media. They've added an artistic piece to that, to the capturing with artists all along the way. And so people like Sylvia Massey and Linda Perry are doing incredible work now. And it's important to note at a conference like this that there's not been a woman winner of Producer of the Year as a Grammy as of yet, as of 2021. So that would be a great thing to try to change, try to remedy at this point in time. So along with people that have made it their livelihood to capture audio, you have physical spaces that have become sort of like temples for popular music. And so places like Motown Studio A in Detroit, where Berry Gordy moved his family to an apartment upstairs and then turned what was a dirt floor garage into, you know, a place where Stevie Wonder and the Supremes and the Temptations were discovered and recorded. Some amazing things done in these temples for music. So RCA Studio B in Nashville, is another one of those places. So I'm sitting playing the piano in that space in this picture, and right behind me there's a cabinet that's where there's a door broken, where Elvis got mad in the middle of the night and kicked the hole there. That's the piano in Muscle Shoals studio in Alabama, where old-time rock and roll was played on that very same keyboard. And that in the picture of Sun Studio in Memphis in the bottom right hand corner is where a 13-year-old Elvis came in to record a song for his mom for her birthday and was discovered. And of course we all know what happened after that. So this studio is actually in my home space, so my home studio that I've taught music for the last year and a half. And so these temples that were very sacred places that we had to have a lot of money to use has now become our homes. It's now become anywhere we can have our laptop or our phone or a tablet. So the idea of speed, accuracy, and proper expression, when we think about what teachers need to know how to do, this is a snapshot. So basically, we have sound, we have media sources, and that's our students, you know. This is a picture of me playing guitar, but there's a media source with sound, and then we have parallel processes of capturing video along with capturing audio. And so right now I have my iPhone recording me for this session, and then I've got my computer that I'll handle the audio side. So I'll take the audio from the phone, and I'll work it through an interface, my computer, and audio and video editing software. And then when we're doing performances in our classrooms, we have live stream software that we've got to understand, and then video sharing platforms. So why all of this effort? Well, during COVID-19, we saw firsthand that we needed to be able to do all these things to be able to socially distance and perform together. So here are some examples from the last year in my life. First, this video from my own music making. So I became a very valuable part of this band because I was the one that knew how to engineer audio to make it sound really good and to take video and merge them together in Final Cut. So translate that over into my job as a music education professor at USF. I was collecting video and audio from my students, who typically I would have six bands in a room. And they each contribute a part, and then we had performances around campus. Well, now we're all in individual dorms, in houses, and we're submitting media in a shared platform, a shared space. So this is one of the bands that that I coached this last fall. PhD program, my doctoral philosophy class, we were so hungry for human interaction with music and sound that we did a collaboration at the end when our, you know, huge final papers were due. We decided to do this around Christmas time. Let another band from my creative performance chamber ensemble class where, everyone met as a band, and I was the person that put together all the media for them and produced the audio. Showed students how to engineer their own audio. It really transformed how they looked at all performance videos, to know that anything that you hear can be auto-tuned, notes can be moved around on the staff, rhythms can be adjusted and changed and fixed. Really made a lot of them believers this last year. So this is one of the students in the class then engineered the audio for the USF Chamber Singers. The student in the upper left-hand corner is the same student that was singing in the last band that you saw. So the whole world of media fluency then focuses on some knowledge and skills and techniques that that we can get from the world of live music recording. And so microphones, dynamic microphones, we learn about them and how they're made and how they're constructed and how they're very durable, and they produce a frequency, a range on the frequency spectrum that looks a particular way. And so microphones like the SM58 by Shure, the SM57 are iconic microphones that are very durable in live performance and recording. And so, in teacher education, we need to start using them and showing students, you know, why they're valuable and what they do well. You know, these large diaphragm and small diaphragm condenser microphones, they do a particular thing. So when we're recording live performances, a pair of AKG C414s placed the right way can capture a beautiful stereo image of a group in any sort of environment, any kind of space. And these small diaphragm condenser microphones pick up the sound of an acoustic guitar beautifully, or a flute trio beautifully, a violin, a quartet beautifully. So. So this whole world requires a lot of knowledge that hasn't been associated with music education in the past or teacher preparation programs, but it should. And we've seen that this last year, that if we know more about these things, we're able to capture fine performances, you know, and not just in times of a pandemic, but all the time. These ribbon microphones were iconic in early days of radio. The voice of Elvis was that RCA 44 up there, one of those in Sun Studios in Memphis. So ribbon microphones capture a beautiful image of a guitar amplifier. And so so we can learn more about them, how to use them, what they do well. These are varieties of USB microphones that don't require an audio interface, so that becomes important at times. And so in this whole world, we look at the frequency spectrum, and in particular microphones have frequency responses. And so that becomes very important depending on what we're trying to record. And microphones have specific patterns. The upper right-hand corner is a polar, a pattern that's very typical in a microphone. So it records an image that's in the front and sort of on the sides, not really in the back, but many microphones, you can change the pattern to get a lot of the pictures that you see there. So microphone placement, here's an XY configuration to produce a stereo image. Sometimes an ORTF configuration is better. Just depends on what you're recording. So things like pop filters, you know, where it's reducing the amount of in front as a vocalist is singing, becomes very important with that large diaphragm condenser microphone that's in the picture. So in the chain, then you have microphones, you have audio interfaces. So to get that audio to your computer, we know this from this year. Many of us didn't know before then, but now have become curious about audio interfaces. They're not all created equal. Some of them have excellent preamps that can make your audio just sparkle. And so here are some really good ones. A couple with two inputs, the one on the bottom with eight inputs. And of course, we have computers, and they're getting better and better and better. The Apple computer that I'm working on right now has an M1 chip that it allows you to do just about anything with video and audio editing. And then you have software, and the biggest rule, the best rule on this is that these digital audio workstations are pretty comparable, and someone who's excellent at GarageBand can produce something that sounds better than someone who doesn't know what they're doing on Logic or maybe Pro Tools. So you have to get in and you have to learn how everything works and be able to manage your plugins and all of those things. And as you do that, your things will look and sound better. And so on the video editing side of things, Final Cut, CyberLink, PowerDirector, Adobe Premiere, a lot of my students were using these on the PC side of things, the Premiere Pro. So, and of course iMovie, Final Cut. So, and then we get to live streaming. So in order to get our performances to an audience, we've got to be able to have a software that takes our media content and takes it to some sort of platform where we can share it. So here are some of those. I used OBS Studio a lot this year. But there's also Wirecast and VidBlaster X. These are some other ones that people have been using, but I've had a lot of good luck with OBS Studio. So Sling Studio, I'd like to share with you this. If you're not familiar with it, this is an excellent platform, sort of an all-in-one package to produce really high quality content using phones, iPhones as cameras. So check out this Sling Studio.
Sling. You most likely know them as a company that created a way for you to stream your home TV channels to your mobile device. They've released a new product, Sling Studio, to record and live stream multi-camera productions. So all of that has become that. On the TechCrunch team, we shoot a lot of video. And every once in a while, I come across something that really impresses me. The Sling Studio is a simple, easy-to-use, and set-up portable production studio. We have a TriCaster at TechCrunch, and we have all the cable and wires and the setup that go with getting it assembled. Don't get me wrong, it's great and a beast of a machine, but it's heavy, and a lot of the time, it's overkill. The Sling Studio simplifies that whole process by making all the cameras wireless and turning your phones into additional cameras you can use with the download of an app. Let's talk about the hardware. The main piece of hardware is the almost 1.5-pound router-looking device that has an SD card slot, HDMI input-output, USB Type-C, and an audio jack so you can get a feed from a mixer. It runs for about $999. The battery makes Sling Studio portable and gives you about 3 hours of life. It goes for $149. The camera link devices are what you're able to connect to any camera with an HDMI output to give them a wireless signal to be able to connect with the Sling Studio. They are priced at $349 each. The USB-C expand.
So you can see and you can follow through and check it out later, but it's an all-in-one unit and it uses phones as cameras, and you can get, so you can have multi-camera video media. And it's very slick. So it's in the band that you saw earlier that I was playing guitar in. We use that with three different camera angles. So it's excellent. So, and then we can talk about video sharing platforms. I use YouTube and Vimeo. But you've also seen people stream from TikTok and Facebook as well. So some examples from practice. So media fluency in practice looks like this. Here's a class of master students at USF, and they're recording audio in stations around the room. So there are six stations in the room, everyone with headphone hub environments where they can hear just the band that they're working with. And so there's a computer at each station where they can record, multi-track record audio. And so you can see them also in live performance then, in those types of settings, they exercise a music teacher as music producer kind of design, where half of what they do is record, half of what they do is perform, and you've got the student in the upper left-hand corner who's engineering the audio, the live audio, for a performance that we did later that week at a coffee shop. And then here's a student band. I like to use a student group. This is the Cheerios. Two of my sons are in this group. And I like to use them for a demo on how to songwrite and what we do to, you know, play with the groove and come up with a good feel for songs. And also I've been recording them and engineering their live audio for students to watch and watch the process. So here's my home studio that I've recorded a lot of people lately, and I've used in a lot of sessions and talks that I've done around Florida and around North America. One in Turkey recently, actually. So we can think of our classrooms differently. This is a particular setup for our two classroom, general ed classrooms, where there are headphone hubs around this perimeter and a teacher station. And I write about a music teacher as music producer, the forthcoming Oxford book, that you should start with a teacher station, assemble all of the components that you need to record high quality audio, and then branch out to the student stations. And so in this particular setup, then there's a live performance setup in another room where students could also use during classroom time, but also it's a nice venue for in the school to bring in, you know, smaller groups of students to listen to your bands perform. This also would be an excellent place to do a live stream performance. So to record multi-camera, perhaps a Sling Studio, capture it well, and then share it with audiences wherever you'd stream. So, and here are examples of small studio spaces, and as we envision what music teachers, music producer looks like in the future, as we're becoming more media fluent, perhaps our rooms look more like these interesting spaces with better lighting and, you know, a nice inviting mood, inspiring to come in and be able to create. So classrooms that look like this with a traditional band and orchestra room, choir room set up with practice rooms might look like have small ensemble stations on the side, and maybe practice rooms have those small ensemble setups. And they look more like these types of spaces. So we can get a lot of inspiration by how people have decorated their studios in our rehearsal spaces. So this is a particular setup that I'll show you from New Zealand. A lot of really interesting things going on in New Zealand and Australia right now, Brisbane, Auckland, New Zealand. And so classrooms that might look like this. One of my dreams is to convert an old church into my own rehearsal space and recording space. So hopefully that will happen at some point. But yeah, you can get some examples of what these spaces might look like. So like I said, so a lot of inspiration we can find in Auckland, New Zealand. So these are three teachers that I saw in the fall of 2018 during my sabbatical. And here are some examples from their rooms. So this particular room, I visited after they had done a live performance the night before. And so you can see some students, they were very tired that day. My son and I joined them. They were fixing some things that had broken the day before and, you know, getting situated back in the room. They knew the Florida professor was coming, so they were ready to carry on their business and show us what they do typically. So you can see the bottom right is a map of the facility that these kids are in. That the kid on the left was recording a group. He's beginning to record a demo of a girl with an original song in her ukulele. That's a band rehearsing in the large rehearsal space. And then in this row of practice rooms, you've got pianos, drums, guitars hanging, everything that the teacher needs to be able to put groups of two or three, even up to five, in each of these practice rooms to rehearse with earplugs to protect their hearing, which is another essential piece of this. But he's getting ready to record the girl down here. So in this other space, they're playing out loud. They can close the door and, you know, this is one of their original songs that they had performed the night before. Song with ukulele being recorded in what was a teacher office converted to a recording space. All right. So Brisbane, Australia, I also visited on the sabbatical, and same thing, the baseline musicianship for the students across the school is small ensembles made up of students in the class covering their favorite music and then working on originals, songwriting as a regular part of the classroom environment. And then electives are large ensembles, so you can elect to play a trumpet or a euphonium and then meet a few times a week with just like low brass or woodwinds, and then one large ensemble practice a week. And they sound great. So this band is in Brisbane, Australia. And this was an amazing space as well with studio spaces, rehearsal spaces. The top left picture is actually a communal space where in between classes, kids are going by all of this plexiglass, and so you have a band in there performing. The sound is controlled with it's surrounded by glass, but the audio is being recorded within the room and then kicked out around the school. So a really cool idea of incorporating live music as a part of the regular school day, but featuring students from the school. So, media fluency is the ability of music teachers to produce media with speed, accuracy, and proper expression for the communities that we serve. We've not traditionally featured this as a part of what we do in teacher education, but we've seen over the last year and a half that it is valuable, certainly during a pandemic, but to be able to capture the audio, capture the performances of our students, both live performance and studio produced art, is something that we can grow in our field. So I've got some examples for you now from practice, but I'm going to end this part of the presentation. I'm hoping to field questions towards the end, and I thank you so much for your attention during this presentation, and I look forward to talking with you now.